So I got down there.
Especially.
And every logger was wearing.
I hear sound.
And everybody, even the white GM down there, she was acting hard. So that's where I worked for her literally. And even she wouldn't go out anymore than any session. That's just also the GM. How did you know about that?
No moonlight screening.
Yeah, maybe some moonlight screening.
Yes.
How you enjoying the avalanche pool?
So far, so good.
I haven't done that yet. I've done enough of it in the past to know how painful it's going to be.
Yeah.
Second highest. I'm glad to see you. Pleasantly surprised when I saw your name on the list. That guy knows everything. He trains army. He knows his stuff.
You forget.
And it was a long time ago.
Right.
Yeah, but the Richards would be in here.
Oh,
good.
Like
No, I met the producer.
Yeah.
That is last year. Starting in July through November.
Yeah, that's what I heard. Some years ago.
I was just not meant to be a singer. It's gonna kind of like some people just like
hi everyone, thanks for coming. We're gonna get started here. This is Rick Rosenthal, a very special guest here at the Science Center. He's a filmmaker. He just did the movie that we saw last night at the Cordova Center, Whale Wisdom. And I'm gonna pass it over to Rick.
Oh, that's good. Hi, everybody. Yeah, and years ago I used to live in Cordova. So, like 1973, that's 50 years ago. It's scary. I'm up here and working with Robert Mussolini back. You know, Robert, we're doing some work on salmon and salmon in the ice, salmon in the snow. So I thought, okay, maybe we'll just show some of the things we've been doing over the years. But this is a recent program. I'm going to show a little bit of it. It played on PBS nationally across the entire country in Europe. And it's called Planet California. And it's about the wild part of California, which most people think of California, Hollywood, you know, movie stars, the beach, Malibu. It's an incredible amount of wildlife. And the geology is really special. So, for a couple of years, we worked really hard on finding those wild places, and not just Yosemite. We worked a little bit there, but our chore was go off-road, find really interesting places, interesting wildlife. So I'll just show a little bit of that, and then we'll go to another little clip, and we can talk about it. But it's great for questions, so when we stop, and don't be shy. Anything you want to ask, I probably won't be an answer. So, okay? So this is Planet California because it's such a big place. It's isolated. It's almost an island. The Spanish called it an island when they come up to Upper California because it's a desert on one side, great mountains, rivers, and the ocean. And that presents an opportunity for endemic species, lots of things to develop, life forms there that you might not see in other parts of the world. So this is one of our programs called Close Encounters. We hope it's there somewhere. right here.
The world's imagination.
Love it.
As much as it does the reality. California. The Golden State. But the truth is, this land of dreams sits in one of the most biologically diverse places on Earth.
Could be a little louder.
So, this is some of the diversity. You have the overhead.
Next to me, some of the world's most exclusive real estate are extraordinary neighbors. Who we are only beginning to understand and care for. They are the true stars of planet California. And they are ready for their close-up. Isolation. An island created by great mountains that hemmed in the north, south, and east. And to the west, the sea. From Pacific beaches to the high reaches of the Sierra Nevada range, the extraordinary variety of landscapes foster myriad endemic species. As people poured in, wildlife was pushed out. But not everywhere. High in the White Mountains, the bristlecone pines remained untouched. The one called Methuselah took root more than 4,500 years ago, making it one of the oldest organisms on Earth. A stubborn survivor in the face of epic change, earthquake, fire, flood, drought. The tree shuts down all of its systems and waits out harsh conditions. When left alone, nature usually finds a way. A concept being tested in California. Off the iconic Big Sur shoreline, a deep sea dweller bears proof. The blue whale. The largest animal to ever live. Years ago, commercial whaling had culled 99% of these magnificent creatures. So the recent appearance of a pod just a few miles offshore is astonishing. The rarest of sightings, mother and calf. These two are in the vanguard of a new generation that has never known whaling. Left alone, their numbers are slowly rebounding along America's west coast. The line of foam reflects the seabed below. Two water masses run side by side, one along the jutting continental shelf, the other over the abyss. When the winds are right, upwellings of nutrients from the deep foster a close encounter between the Titanic and Tiny. Blue whales and krill. up from the edge of a world long out of our reach. Some of the continent's deepest canyons and most spectacular mountains just south of San Francisco, all of it underwater. The acclaimed Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute studies this submerged terrain with remote vehicles, pushing our understanding of the outer edges of life on Earth. Nearly a mile down, the ROV enters an everlasting night. Researchers record species and habitats, tracking changes, not making them. It's a radically different first encounter from California's early explorers. Sponges and corals colonize canyon walls, a deep sea habitat that, because of its inaccessibility, has seldom been glimpsed till now. Down here, where the sun never shines, about 90% of animals make their own light. Californians don't have to go to extremes to meet their aquatic neighbors. A walk to the beach will do. On early summer nights, bioluminescent algae can swarm in millions, turning the waves a radiant blue. And on a few extraordinary nights, on particular beaches, there's dancing in the moonlight. Riding the high tide, thousands of grunion, a California native, come ashore to mate. The female burrows in and waits for a male to cozy up and fertilize her eggs. A guitar fish pops out of the water as well, grabbing a quick bite at the amorous event. Beyond the surf line, another mating frenzy reveals the secret of sustainable fishing. The tentacles of excited male squid flash red and iridescent green as they clasp their mates. The females deposit eggs on the shallow sea floor in seemingly inexhaustible abundance. Calamari is California's most productive fishery, thanks to responsible fishing and a prolific reproduction rate. The entire population replaces itself annually. But heading down the Pacific Coast Highway, another resurgent species is a reminder of unintended consequences. Elephant seals are deep divers who spend most of their lives far out to sea. They break that habit to give birth, molt, and mate. To beat the heat, they bury themselves in cool sand. While cows sunbathe, bulls throw their considerable weight around. They vie for supremacy and the right to breed. The alpha male dispatches his challengers quickly. The losers take out their frustrations by trying to mate with young pups. It's perilous to be a youngster. Better to stay out of the way. These pups are teaching themselves how to swim in a shallow and ephemeral freshwater creek, a curious adaptation for one of the ocean's deepest diving animals. The dramatic scene on the beach draws hundreds of thousands of tourists annually. Just steps away from a parking lot, they can watch a spectacle that a century ago had nearly vanished from the world. Hunted for their blubber like the blue whale, only 100 were left. Now, with complete protection, the population in California has risen to nearly 150,000, which has led to another resurgence. Seals are the favorite prey of great white sharks, whose numbers are also growing. Big waves and great whites, both are found near San Francisco and Mavericks. The legendary surf spot lies in the Red Triangle, the largest concentration of white sharks in the North Pacific. But that doesn't deter the world's most daring surfers. Ryan Seelbach has been riding Mavericks for 20 years. As a geologist, he understands what makes this place special.
Mavericks is really big, and bigger than a lot of the other waves here along the coast. Primarily of the geology, it's a shallow rock. Shelf and explodes over that shelf.
An adventure athlete, Seelbach relishes what nature puts in his path.
Surfing Mavericks is a ton of trial and error, you know, trying to paddle for waves and you don't get them. I think we paddle for probably a lot more waves than we get to ride.
The Giants can reach as high as a six-story building.
When it breaks, you feel it. Your whole body bounces.
The water is frigid, about 50 degrees Fahrenheit. A mistake can mean serious injury.
At Mavericks, you got these giant mountains, this cliff, these rocks, and you're about half a mile out of the sea. And you get put in these situations where you just feel like you just gotta be able to save yourself.
A close encounter, not for the faint of heart. Miles down coast in the Santa Barbara Basin, warm currents from the south clash with the California Current, a cold water river in the sea that comes from the north. It's a potent mix, sparking a burst of life seldom seen so close to shore. A great shoal of fish rises. Dolphins know how to read the signs when the event is underway. Seabirds answer the dinner gong too. Anchovies and sardines feed in the upper layers of the California Current, where sunlight triggers plankton blooms and fires up the food chain. The massive shoal is both a shield and magnet, guarding the fish and attracting hunters simultaneously. The little fish crowd together, attacked from below and above. Crafty California sea lions push the panicked fish back together, picking off strays as they go. Lunging through the middle, mouth wide open, the humpback whale isn't so delicate, swallowing tons of fish in a single gulp. In minutes, the bait ball vanishes, leaving only scales behind. The survivors of the slaughter scatter to nearby stands of giant kelp in the Channel Islands National Marine Sanctuary, home to countless billions of animals, and a conservation success story. Topping out at more than 500 pounds and living up to 75 years, the giant sea bass was prized by sport and commercial fishermen alike. By 1982, it had become so scarce, many scientists feared it had disappeared altogether. 40 years later, with protected laws and protected habitat, the emergence of a young school in the kelp forest spawns new hope. The giant sea bass avoids the California sea lions that make the forest their playground. The sea lions can't resist breaking up the bass party. They chase the fish into the canopy, not to eat them, but simply for the sport of it. Restoring ecosystems allows all to thrive. From the waving arms of the brittle starfish to the California sheephead, which knows a little about transformation. The immature fish is yellow. As she grows, she turns a dull pink. And when she's half grown, she transitions to the black head and tail, showing that she is now a he, ready to claim and defend a breeding range. The striking orange color of California's official state fish, the Garibaldi, should make it a target for predators, but nobody pushes these flashy characters around. Fiercely territorial, the males prepare and maintain the algal nest for their offspring. Like an obsessive gardener, he fusses over the vegetation, nibbling it to an exact height. He fans the bright yellow eggs, aerating them with oxygen. When an egg-eating sea urchin wanders onto the nest, the protective father unceremoniously shows it the way out.
So, what'd you think? It's amazing the diversity. That's just a little bit of California, but I think that there are a lot of critters and habitats that are similar to up here. You have your kelp forests. I worked years in the kelp forest, studying everything from the giant kelp and the kelp herring roe out here to all the way to the tip of South America, and how important kelp is as a habitat. And more, especially with climate change, we're looking at ecosystems, habitat, not just single species. And things are changing completely with warming climate, seawater warming, and that's a major issue, and you're gonna see things here as they change as well. The importance of marine protected areas is illustrated in some of those shots, especially with the return of the giant sea bass. When I was in graduate school, we rarely saw the giant sea bass. They were being commercially harvested, and they just could not take that pressure. And they lived, you know, up to 100 years, and not just the giant sea bass, but the protection around the islands, a small area, and that spills over and filters out into other areas off the California coast. The other, I think, lesson is well illustrated with the elephant seal. You know, at the turn of the century, they were considered almost extinct. And with protection, that population has grown almost over 100,000 animals. You can see that. You can rent a car, drive along the Big Sur down the coast, and you can walk down the board and watch that in action. And that's hard to see anywhere, unless you go to Africa or something like that. It all happens right there, and you don't have to get down on the beach. You're not allowed in to watch that, and that's, I think, really special. The other thing, the surprise is the deep sea, right off of Monterey, you know, in the wine country. Just we were out maybe 20 miles offshore, and all those creatures are down there. And for only in the last few decades
has anyone been able to see those kind of animals? And that was because of new tools like submarines and remote vehicles that they can fly around down there. How many have been to the Monterey Bay Aquarium? Many people here. You know, it's really a stunning aquarium, the best in the world. And part of their work is they have a research center north of the aquarium called Embari, and that was the money of David Packard, Hewlett Packard. And he wanted a research foundation with biologists and engineers. And he said, if you don't work together, I'm gonna take my money away. But it's top-notch deep sea research. Every month they're finding new species. And that's right out there. We thought, how is that possible? But they're not taking them in nets and they're meshing them together. Like if we're trawling out here, which we did, and other ways to capture deep sea animals, by the time they came up, it looked like a bunch of gelatinous snot almost. So when you see them in their realm and lit up properly, and they're doing behavior now as well, it's Candyland. It's magic. To see squid, which how many people eat calamari here? I'm sure you've had them every restaurant. Right off California, that's one of the great fisheries for Lobago, the market squid, and that's right there. And on the beach, grunion there coming in to spawn. So it's just a little tidbit of that kind of a world. And I'll show a little bit more if you'd like me to. Anybody have questions?
Did you run the camera on this? Any of this?
Did I?
Yeah.
Yes. Right there.
Yes.
I do camera work.
No, I mean, what we're watching, you run the camera on some.
Did I shoot some of this?
Yeah.
Probably half of it. Yeah, at least. So, yeah, I'm still capable, I guess. What else? Yes.
The corals, the deep sea corals, that was kind of cool. We went to a talk in Florida, and they were making artificial coral. So I don't know, are you just about the bleaching and the...
Were they doing, you're talking restoring coral reefs?
Yeah.
Yeah, restoring.
Yeah.
Yeah, the coral reefs are in really tough shape around the world.
Yeah.
And I was just down in the Bahamas, and one of the companies that's in coral restoration in the Bahamas, because a lot of that is from climate change.
Yeah.
Coral bleaching, acidic changes, and the coral reefs protect the islands. And they provide the habitat for all kinds of species and for fishing. And they're worried all over the world about the coral reefs. If you lose something like the Great Barrier Reef off of Australia, it's a game changer. And that there are a number of companies trying to put out corals, and they bring in pieces of corals, grow them in the lab, take them back out on the reefs and try to restore them. So it is a major thing, and you were in the Florida Keys or somewhere down in Florida to see that. So that's going on worldwide. Here in California, and up here we have some deep sea corals.
Yeah, that's what it was.
Yeah.
Are there corals up here?
Yes.
Okay.
Very deep, and the bottom trawlers get them occasionally, and we never even knew those were there. But shrimp trawlers used to pick up deep sea corals up here. Pass by some of the stuff and see if we can find something cool.
So do you do a lot of free diving, or do you have
Yes.
Yeah.
No, a lot of my work was free diving for years.
Okay.
Yeah, to get close to these animals. And nobody likes, you kids don't like to see sharks, do you? Great. You like sharks?
Okay.
All right. Let me show you this. This is right off of Hollister, and just down the beach is the University of California, and right Santa Barbara.
Long
right
before Santa Barbara became a popular surf spot, it attracted hundreds of lusty leopard sharks. Leopard sharks don't attack people. Ignoring the beachgoers, they scan the sandy bottom for food and look for mates. They're year-round residents, unlike the great whites. Adolescent white sharks just visit. Surfers aren't seals, though from underneath, their boards may bear a resemblance. California protected great whites in 1994 when their numbers had plummeted. The appearance of these juveniles is a sign that it's working, if perhaps alarming to the people who share the water. This one heads south, seeking better hunting.
Okay, let's go a little further inland in California, and I'm going to show you what happens at night. This is a great area called the Carrizo Plain, and it's one of the last grasslands left on the west coast of North America. And it was farmed, and the farmers for wheat, and it didn't work, dried up, so now it's a national monument. But we went out there and worked.
It's tenuous, and untenable.
And you can see it's pretty dry.
The Carrizo Plain is the last remnant of a grassland that once stretched hundreds of miles through the center in California. After a tough go of it, farmers have left it to the wild things. With temperatures regularly rising into the triple digits, most animals head underground to a vast network of tunnels. The original Hotel California. When the sun is low, irrepressible kit foxes pop out to play. No longer threatened by plows and pesticides, they may yet reclaim their home. There's plenty of competition for the endemic San Joaquin antelope squirrel. The kid fox father scours the expanse for food for his pups. With only 7,000 kid foxes left in the world, his mission is critical. The father will need to find more to keep them all satisfied. The rattlesnake is an ambush hunter. It waits for its toxin to work before consuming the paralyzed rodent. Some creatures. Grasshoppers love the drought. They're a staple food for many of the residents in the Carrizo grassland. One grasshopper makes a full meal for an adult burrowing owl. But not enough to share with his chicks. Having fortified himself, he brings them a spider. Below the surface, something is happening. The tunnel dwellers sense it first. Soon the tremors rattle even the elk. Planet California experiences some 10,000 earthquakes along the San Andreas Fault, which runs right through the Carrizo grasslands. Unlike in human homes, a collapsed wall from the shaking earth is no big deal here, just another dirty job. As the sun goes down, the dry lands awake. And an intrepid biologist goes to work. His groundbreaking technology shows the inner workings and interdependence of an entire community. It is a hidden world, full of sound and scent. Alive to them, blind to us. Time for the elusive architect of Hotel California to make its debut. The kangaroo rat, which is neither kangaroo nor rat, though it is remarkably industrious. Reveals things even the animals are unaware of. The badger doesn't see the kangaroo rat, allowing the prey to slip away. The rat's territory is a matter of a few hundred feet, and it fights to defend its turf from intruders. Thumping its foot, it warns others to keep out. Truly, the tunnel-digging kangaroo rat is an excellent host, offering room, board, and a floor show at the Hotel California. Even a rattler cannot phase the pugnacious rodent. Its massive hind legs can hurl the kangaroo rat 9 feet into the air, the equivalent of a human leaping over 100 feet. Ringing the Central Valley grasslands is one of California's dominant habitats.
Question, is a kangaroo rat an amazing animal? That gave us what? Working with new tech, infrared cameras, infrared light at night, high-speed cameras. That's all a world we would never see, but here's this little dude that can jump 9 or 10 feet in the air. And everything's because of the temperatures, the heat, the lack of cover. The burrows are really important, so they stay at pretty much a regular temperature. Everything kind of lives in the burrows, and all the creatures come out of that. So with infrared, around down there. I want to show you, and it's not sound, and I'll just narrate it maybe or do something here. Yeah. I want to show you a little salmon, a little river. Klamath River in Northern California. This is Yurok country. This is their reserve. One time it was much larger. The river was one of the most important rivers in California. One of the big rivers that could support Chinook or king salmon. And back in time, many years ago, they started building dams on it. And the dams not only reduced the population of salmon, but turned it into almost like a shallow lake in areas, and a lot of problems with toxic algae, and the fish had at one time 300 miles of spawning territory, and now they're restricted to just so many miles. Now, in the last few weeks, months, they've negotiated. They've been trying to take the dams down and breach the dams, and they've finally come to an agreement with the government, and that those dams are going down. But I want to show you at the mouth of the river on the Klamath what the action can be with nature. So this California current, as you see there, is running down the coast. It's cold water, bringing nutrients, lots of food, plankton. And when that passes by the Klamath River, it's a food chain. It's just like a highway. And all this life is out there. And here comes the jellyfish, so here we go. California gray whale's passing by, but I want to get to the, you can see that here. Look at the sea lions here. My goodness. So these are California sea lions, but also the Steller sea lion, which you have up here, is coming down there as well. So here's the mouth of the river, the Klamath. We're up on the hillside there filming, or down on the beach, or flying a drone. The drone is one of our most important tools now to tell stories, film, and also record behavior we could never do before as biologists. So here you got your California sea lion surfing in on the waves to get to the mouth of the river. And the Chinooks are starting to come up river. No longer are there wild Chinooks. They're supplementing that with hatchery fish above, up by the dams. But the battle begins out there for the limited number of king salmon. And you can see the power of these sea lions throwing the fish and catching them in this area. Just, it's an amazing show going on there. Now, certainly they want to somehow reduce the number of sea lions there and increase the number of salmon. This is one of the big problems. There's just not enough salmon there. Only 1,000 go up the river, where it might at one time ran 1 million fish. It was that important a river. So it is a big battle going on there. And also coming in are Steller sea lions. And they're, as you've seen them out here, they're the light colored ones, see, with not a crest on their head. And they're pretty tough guys. I've swam with them out here years and years ago when no human had ever been underwater with Stellars. And we had a lot of encounters with Stellar sea lions diving, grabbing us by the back of the tank, dragging us around, stealing our sample bags. But you can see the Stellar just woofed down that salmon, just swallowed it whole. And this is a California, almost like a circus animal, bouncing on his nose. So to get the shots and to see this happens only a few weeks and not every year. You have to be there. And some of the salmon are actually going up on the beach to escape. They're running right along the shoreline with all this craziness and competition. Here's the harbor seals you have right out here fighting over one of the salmon, just pulling it apart. And the harbor seal is a much smaller animal, and it can't compete with the Stellar sea lion. Now this salmon went up onto the beach along the shore there. And you know, that's not the escape route you want, because someone's always there, and oh, this little harbor seal sees that. Oh, this is my chance to get a meal, a meal. This is a trophy for him, trophy Chinook, all by himself. Nobody's there. He's going to finally get one, but somebody's watching. One of the California sea lions is watching this, and is going to interact with this. But the little harbor seal feels, I've got it. We had our cameras right down there, and in comes this huge California sea lion, just right there. To have your camera there is very, very special. And just one sling, heads off, whoop, gone. So there's some of the competition along the beach and in the shallow water at the mouth of the Klamath River. We followed that river up river and worked with one of the tribal spokesmen, lawyer, Amy Cordalis, and is in a big fight to try to save the Klamath and bring it back to being a proper historic river. So going upstream, it's beautiful streams in these areas, but fish don't come very often. They just can't get up there. This was Amy up there, and I'm sorry I don't have sound right now on this, but when they pulled their nests, empty. Very few. Sometimes they can't even fish because of such poor years. And these are the dams. So, you know, dams and fish just don't work together. And they didn't plan any ladders, any way in the past for the fish to go around. They built the dams and went, oops. And that's happened in the Columbia River and other great rivers in the West, where they ruined the salmon resource. So that's, you know, that's what's going on up here. And this is just a little bit that I was in some of the streams that are still have wild spawning going on. And this is a king salmon, a Chinook, in with steelhead and cutthroat trout and baby Chinook salmon. In these shallow creeks that are still cold enough, that's the secret too. It'll really be up here, cold water with a lot of food. And it's the salmon that are feeding the forest. When they die like that, their flesh, the nutrients go into the forest, it goes into the creatures that live along the river. That is the keystone species in the river. If the salmon go, the ecosystem collapses. And that's the message of that. So, and it's all, a lot of this is underground, which is really amazing. These are the great redwood trees, and now we're learning that not only these trees grow, the tallest tree in the world, over 300 feet, they take a lot of their moisture from the air, not just from the root system. But in the root system, I'll just play this a little. The root system of these trees, and we're finding this, scientists are around the world, how important the root system and the fungus, the fungi are at providing food and essentially working together in a commensal way. And some of the scientists now today believe that the trees are talking to each other. And you know, when you walk through the forest, you thought, well, I feel a little, something's happening here, but there's communication, and that communication is underground. And so if you go underground in these trees and look in this mycorrhizal world, this microscopic world, a lot is going on. So it's not just looking above in the overstory. Now the science is going to the understory and beneath the soil to look at that, the importance of the of this completely new realm and the role of the microorganisms in that, in those forests. So that is new biology, new science. So I think that's probably enough right now, right? It's an hour. Yeah, questions, comments? Yeah.
How are sea otters doing on the coast of California?
The sea otters are kind of maintained. They're not really growing, I don't think. It's about food. We know what they eat up here, you know, it's, and, you know, I think they're limited by the food. So they've tried to keep them out of certain areas. I guess you've been to Channel Islands, but a sea otter is, you know, a pretty smart dude, and that they have limited their numbers also in terms of spreading out, breeding, migrating to new areas, but it's not been an explosion. Came back, California sea otter was considered extinct up until somebody saw them. Margaret Owen sitting on a hillside in 1939-40, and whoops, otter, there are otters hidden away in that Monterey area, a couple of little groups of them. I know when I first came to Alaska before here, we worked at off Sitka, north of Sitka on Chichagof Island, and Kobe, West Chichagof. And we went up there, and they had been transplanted from the Aleutians and brought, when they were doing atomic testing, the government and the state of Alaska were feeling they had to move some of those otters because they're all going to be killed by the atomic testing. And they put them off of Sitka North. And at that time, there was, I think when I started looking at them, they were transplanted in 65, and we were there in 71. And their numbers were only growing. Just sea urchins, but all the invertebrates, the Alaskan abalone, sea urchins, barnacles, yada, yada, yada. And then that group, as we know, has spread along the entire coast here, when the otters were also transplanted. And up here, when I first lived here, as you know, the clam beds were very important, the Dungeness crab beds. Pretty much gone, aren't they? Or Pete, what's going on?
Not many razors around, that's for sure.
Yeah.
They're eating horse clams.
Yeah.
Big ones.
The big guys, yeah. The tresses. So, yeah. Very similar areas. We're on the West Coast. A lot of the animals, the rockfish you find up here, you know, we found them all the way down to California and Lincoln. So it's not just California, it's the West Coast and the similarities and also the migration and ecosystems can be a little different, but the same issues, the same kinds of creatures. Anything else?
Are sea stars coming back?
Yeah, the sea stars, you know, starfish just had an epidemic.
Right.
Like, yeah, they're starting to see small sea stars again. And I don't know what up here we have issues at all, but we did. It was just catching that bay here. You know, the big 20 rayed starfish was really common right out here. A lot of those starfish just disappeared as a virus, wasn't it? Anyway, I think that's probably good, unless there's another question.
Okay, I just have one question. You said that you did over half the filming in the California section.
Part of it, yeah.
Yeah, and I was just wondering, like, how many different kinds of cameras are you using? You know, are you having to be proficient on, like,
how do we cover it? huge area.
Yeah.
It wasn't easy, and we also included Baja.
Yeah.
Because that is California. And it, we worked with about 8 different camera people in those areas. It was during COVID, too, a lot of it. So it was good and bad. We could travel around and go to like Sequoia National Park. No one was there. The rangers weren't there, blah, blah, blah. So in some ways, we camped, or we stayed in little cottages, and it was, a lot of the critters were out. People weren't running over all the parks and stuff, but it's a big undertaking, and we work generally with specialists, somebody that can fly a drone underwater, diving, land, desert. So we have a connection with a half a dozen camera people that were working with us, and also to say, this is what we were kind of looking for. And then other things, we had to just go out, like in the Carrizo Plain, and up in the Sierra, we had to just learn to do it, work with some of the researchers, and even at night work, scientists don't see what you just saw, the kangaroo rat and all those things. Just
so that kangaroo rat, how many frames a second was that filled?
Fast. Yeah, I can't even tell you, but you know, up pushing up to 1,000 frames. Yeah, to see that. Yeah.
Infrared and.
Yeah, yeah. The infrared stuff was just electric. The mountain lions we did with infrared at night, with kittens and mommies, and they not picking up. We had a camera right near their little den or their areas that they were feeding on, and that just opened the window to see all this great behavior without disturbing. Even those burrowing owls, you could not get close to a camera unless you put a camera near them and just got away and let it run. So we came up with trail cams that actually ran for 12 hours without missing the behavior. So things are certainly good in terms of doing camera work, but we need more critters in the habitat. But the tools we have now are fantastic. You know, they're quiet, you know, they're digital, you can see what you're doing right away. Before, when I shot movie, motion picture film, we had to send it into a laboratory. We might get it back a week or two later. And sometimes it was pretty touch and go. You know, I worked with the BBC for years, and on all their top series like Planet Earth, Blue Planet, Life, and you know, if we were shooting film before that, you didn't know. You're looking through the viewfinder, you send in your roll of film and hope that there weren't any techno problems. Now, you know right away that you've gotten something good or average or you got to do it again. Yeah. Yeah.
What brought you to Cordova originally? I'm assuming you weren't doing this kind of work.
Yeah, I was doing marine biology, and I was using a still camera and diving. And when we started working in Prince William Sound, then no one was doing intertidal subtidal work. University of Alaska was doing a little bit, and Auk Bay Lab was diving in southeast in the Inside Passage, but not on the outer coast. And then I had projects with the state and the feds for the rockfish fishery off of southeast. And it was I was at Scripps Institution of Oceanography and came up to Alaska, and it was just because it was wild and big and had a lot of cool things going on. And for a young guy, a biologist, it was like, Cordova did not have this. The Science Center, which you guys should be really proud of. It did not have the museum in that theater there. That's beautiful. We showed the film last night, of a whale film I did. And outstanding projection and sound. You know, that's first class, that theater.
I showed it to the kids at the house today.
With the well, no, in that big theater, it was just, it was wonderful. If you missed it, I'm sorry. So there are some things here, and I think the thing about the sound, despite the Exxon Valdez oil spill, which I was in, and not a happy camper, you have access to all kinds of wildlife and habitats that you don't have. And just get out of town a little ways, and it's wild. You know, it's. There are no cities, there's no highways, no super highways, and you can be very close to town and see lots of stuff, either on the sound or in the rivers.
As a biologist, yeah. You were talking about the drones and what a difference they've made for this kind of work.
Right.
As a biologist, do you see, it seems like every year our fish and game gets less and less financing for
research yeah.
and doing surveys.
Right.
And in the past, a lot of the surveys out on the flats have been done out of a Super Cub with
right.
with a fish and game biologist that doesn't like to fly,
yeah.
doesn't want to be up there in the first place.
Right.
And so I just wonder if you see any possibility that drones could be doing.
Oh, I think drones could do lots of things. There are certain animals that they certainly spook and put them off. You have to be careful of that, or the altitude you fly. But other things, it's a game changer. But what you have to do is have people trained to know how to fly the drone properly around wildlife and not be just, you know, cowboy like flying them.
And be so able to dive immediately when an eagle comes after it.
We've had an eagle, a golden eagles knock one of our drones down in California. The golden eagle, which is interesting. And we, you, on YouTube, they had stuff of golden eagles in Europe knocking down drone. And we're flying in the Sierra one beautiful morning, pulled up to this, near Bishop, California, up to this great canyon, and it was like 10 in the morning, perfect light, quiet, and we were working with one of the bighorn sheep scientists, and the young biologist, cameraman works with me, everything's a go, he lifts off with a drone, we're sitting there, it's flying up this little canyon, just gets into the entrance of the canyon, and we see two eagles swoop down, come across the canyon. You know, we didn't think of it as anything of that. And then a few minutes later, he said, I've lost the picture. I've lost it completely, lights out. And because those kind of drones don't send you back anything, you know, that you got smacked or whatever. So, and about a few minutes later, two more golden eagles came down along there. And you know what? Our drone was gone. It fell somewhere in this great canyon. You can't find it, but that's the only time we've lost a drone. But I really, in answer to your question, I think it's a great tool. And unfortunately, in all the labs and fish and game and fish and wildlife, the funds have been cut, and everybody's working on a computer in an office, and it's kind of like, what's the data?
Right.
And that's the scary thing of not having good field biologists out doing what they were trained to do. And it can't all be about models. And you know, the rough and tumble out there in the field, the stuff that Pete does with the shorebirds, it's critical to be out there. And I would think then that, and I don't know the fish and game guys anymore, I did all the top. I was an advisor to Jay Hammond when he was governor here. He was the best governor we ever had. Coolest dude too. And then, you know, there was room for research. But that's true of everywhere, that the research is being cut. A lot of it has to come from private, like the Monterey Bay Aquarium. They don't rely on so much government money, but that's a special deal. So, but citizen science can help too, to get people out and helping with the scientists. But in the flats, I don't know what. Are you talking about the bird population or salmon or little
more,
everything?
More of the salmon population.
Right. Salmon, perfect. Perfect. You don't have to be flying if you can get within several miles of where the drone's going to work.
So a safe range for
yeah.
the drones you're
yeah.
using, what would that be?
Line of sight. But we've flown them out miles, and we've taken them up higher than you want. You could certainly work all the way out to the bridge. Why not? All those areas out there, including that. So if the water's clear enough to be able to see with a Super Cub, certainly the drone will give you much more, and it'll give you the data. You'd be able to play it back and play it back and play it back. And then the fishermen and other people that are using the resource can believe it. You know, that there's, you know, spawning population, the return of those population of fish, and also issues with habitat and with climate change, or some creeks that might be really important in terms of spawning creeks, what's going on out there, and predators. I don't know if the bears are going to be bothered by it. Some of the other animals are, if you're flying too low. otherwise. It sounds at times, they're getting quieter. It sounds almost like bees, or it's in certain things like horses that are not thrilled by listening to that. So, and in the marine mammal counts on all these haulade areas, rookeries, otters, perfect. You'll know how many otters are out there flying. And you don't have to have a big ship. So lobby for that, you know, force them to do that, because it's like anything, a lot of the, you know, the ways to work have to change. There's new tools to use, and it can't be just, as I said, somebody just wants to learn to fly a drone, and then you're not going to get a lot out of it. But that's really good, really good question. Anything else?
Can you tell us what you're working on now?
Huh?
I'm working on something cool.
It's really cool. How many people know of manta rays? You know this big manta ray? I can show you something if you
We're doing okay on time if you want to show something.
What? So the manta ray for centuries was called the devil fish. You know, humans considered the most dangerous animal in the ocean. And that's because maybe they got entangled in fishing nets or lines and drug the boats around or whatever. In fact, they're one of the gentlest animals in the ocean. They have a huge brain, the largest brain in the fish world. We're not sure what fish are even, because they've lumped 30,000 species as fish. Just because you go into water and do it, are they all fish? You know, this was taxonomous, putting everything in there. The manta ray doesn't fit, it's almost an outlier. And its brain has been not only described as a large brain, but they're doing neurological work on the brain. So I got interested in it from swimming with them for years, doing little things, and it's like an alien. It comes in this big spaceship.
Or like a ballerina.
And doing all kinds of things. And if you've ever got a chance to swim with them, Hawaii?
Australia.
Yeah, okay. So it's great. So you want to see a little clip? So we're working on manta rays. It's called Alien Contact. And a friend of mine is Chris Carter from X-Files. Ever watched that series? Chris lives up near me. And we talked about it a little bit. And we're not making it like Little Green Men and little aliens, but it's more this creature. What is this creature and how smart is it? So I'll see if I can put something on here. Just our little sizzle. That's where we're going. So this is what we call sizzle. We call it a trailer or something. You get broadcasters interested in your film. You write a proposal, you pitch it. We don't just do a film and then try to sell it. My partner and my wife, we go to broadcasters and say, hey, is this cool or what? And it's very difficult now, because just like what you're talking about, the people at Geographic, National Geographic, Discovery, they're all into reality television, you know, chase the animals around, a lot of BS, and they don't realize the time it takes for us to do a program. California took us several years. The whale film that we showed the other night, several years. And when the young executives hear that, they kind of go, a couple of years? We send a crew out in 12 days, and we have somebody on camera. They rely a great deal on the presenter. And, don't do that in terms of that kind of a program. So this is Alien Contact. It will be on sometime, but let's see. Okay. from there. Yeah, so that's our program interaction, the stage will be called Fine Cut, where our writer is delivered her script, our musicians or composers are working on music. To do a wildlife film, or any film, documentary, you're doing the same things you would have to do for a feature film. We have camera people, we have editors, key, writer, sound design, composer, and we're working on that, and we're then at that stage, and it should be a couple more months to finish and get approval from, because we take our films to Europe, and they're some of our best clients, the Germans, the French, British, Austrians. I work a lot with a group called Terra Mater, which is a division of Red Bull. Red Bull. The owner of Red Bull, who just passed away, and if you like adventure sports, they've been supporting all that, all over the world. And he wanted a factual television group that did good work, and they set it up in Vienna. So we go to Vienna, which is not the worst place to go. It's a beautiful city, and we work out of there. So that's what our manta rays show. Some of those manta rays, I was working with a scientist in Ecuador, they measured one was 24 feet in wingspan. Is that 20 feet across here? Just about 24?
36.
Hmm?
36.
Whatever it is, they're big. They get big. So that's a cool thing.
So you are a biologist at your core. You started as a biologist. How did you develop your skills in videography? Film, was that just like happenstance or through research?
It was a lot of trial and error and screw it up and learning, especially with movie film, because you couldn't look at it, it's very expensive. A 10-minute roll of movie film is $150. To process it is another $150. This is backwards. That's $300 in 10 minutes. And then to get that. And then I was shooting stills, but to formed into motion is really difficult. With my working video camera, you get to see it. So it was that, and then I started doing some things. I did a film for the state of Alaska called Beneath Alaska Tides, which is an underwater camera, in the 1980s. And then I decided this is something I want to do after years of being a biologist, to get the stories out, to reach people. Nobody read our research paper. Was about trying to work with a different medium. So that's what I did. And I went to the BBC in England, and they said, well, we like, you know, we know you're a top diver and you have all these ideas and whatever, but you gotta get up to speed as a camera work. We see the best stuff in the world. So there were three Americans working at the BBC. And we then started to not only shoot for them, but also produce the film. And they're really tough. They're really tough to work with. They see great stuff. And it just, my career kept developing, and I got to really great assignments to work on. One of them was on salmon. It's called Miracle of Scarlet Salmon. It was on the PWSSC across the country. And then eventually, as one of the primary cameramen went on Blue Planet, Planet Earth, Life, all those. Have you guys seen any of those series? Or,
I watched that whole series twice. I was very
impressed. About three times. Okay. So that's what I did. And it was a gamble, absolute gamble, because my friends in biology said, are you crazy? You know, I had good jobs. And I thought, I should do it. And I'm still standing. And the main thing is to stay fit, because I have to be swimming out in the big ocean or climbing, and I can't do what I used to do, so I have to work with big, strong guys like that at times. So that's the story, and I want to thank the Science Center. You've got a really great facility here, and we'll come back sometime, I guess. But alien contact will be on, and you can find our whale film, Whale Wisdom, on believe if you go to Amazon Prime, it may lead you to Curiosity Stream as a new streaming service. So that's where it is. The streaming services picked up our film. We never got anything when we signed these contracts. So all these different groups, Netflix, all blah, they all have them and they pass them around. So it's a, you know, it was something in contracts years ago we never knew was coming. Who knew about streaming, right? It's going to happen like that. And it just went, it just exploded. Now there's too many groups, as usual, so they're not making the money they did. But the way we work is to go to the broadcasters and sit and talk with them and show them stuff. And it's really hard to get a new film if you haven't done films before, because they don't want to take any risks, like any business, I guess. So that's the Manta Ray show. It'll be on next year, not sure in the States, but stay tuned. And thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
And thanks to Christina, who kept it going.
Thank you for coming, Ray. Yeah. Thanks everyone who came. There are Tuesday night talks are starting back up on the 17th. The flyers are able to grab on your way out.
That's true.